to Wailua United Church of Christ. My name is Pat Pedro, and I join our guest pastor, Keith Winterow, and our worship team in leading today's service on this Communion Sunday. We are happy you have joined us for worship, whether you are here in person or joining us online. Let's turn to your neighbor and greet them with a warm welcome.
When those trials come, for the victory that growing brings in surrendering everything. Life is so worthwhile. We thank you, Lord, that everything is put in place. Out in front we can see your face, and that's where you belong. But it goes against the way we are.
If you're able, please rise for our call to worship.
Please join me in reading our call to worship. The words can be found in the bulletin or on the screen. Good morning, Holy Spirit.
Good morning, Holy Spirit.
Open the eyes of our heart, Lord.
Yes, Lord, we want to see with understanding.
As sons of God, we are led by the Spirit of God.
As sons of God, we are led by the Spirit of God.
Let us continue with our prayer and confession in unison. Let us pray. Father, we thank you for your everlasting kindness, and we give you thanks for you have blessed us with every spiritual blessing. Christ Jesus, and in you, we lack no good thing.
Morning, church family. Thank you for being so patient. The call to worship says we...
Okay, now, we need to do the word to worship.
Sorry. Okay.
Thank you, Jesus. You know, as I'm watching everybody get ready this morning, ready for the service, I'm really impressed by how many people serve here. And what does Jesus count as greatness in the kingdom of God? It's not the person that sits on the throne, it's the people that serve. So I really want to commend the people that are involved in helping everything works smoothly, because, you know, God remembers that stuff. And he doesn't just remember it for today, he remembers it forever. You know. Father, we thank you for your amazing love. And even as we said earlier, Holy Spirit, we welcome you today. We are so thankful for you. So thankful. And Lord, we commit this time into your care. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Sorry about that. Let's try to embrace off, Father, let's awaken our spirits.
It is the pride of my heart to be a father. So we have several perfect requests this morning. The grandparents of the Claro family. I hope I'm not butchering any names. Okay, please forgive me. They're in the hospital due to sickness, and so we're praying for a speedy recovery. So Father, in Jesus' name, we ask you right now to touch by the Spirit of God these grandparents in the Claro family. Raise them up, Father, may call for rapid, supernatural, speedy recovery in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen. And we have a perfect request for Catherine Akaki. For healing, she's got quite a cough. And that's a very unpleasant situation. So, Father, we lift Catherine up to you right now in Jesus' name. And in Jesus' name, Lord, fill her lungs, Lord, with the Spirit of God. Fill her lungs and cry out that sickness in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Take authority over that sickness and the command to leave her body now in Jesus' name. And we speak life and victory over Catherine right now. Thank you, Father. And we have a prayer request from Ben Takahashi, who has a virus, a cold. Same story, Father. No, it's not your will. So in Jesus' name, we command this virus to depart, we command this cold to clear up in the name of Jesus. We thank you for your tender mercies, Father, for all your works, that which she is in Jesus' name. And finally, the John E. Sharp Ohana. They lost, is it a sister-in-law they lost? Oh, on his passing. No, John's passing. Father, we ask for mercy for this family, and we ask for much comfort, much grace right now, in Jesus' name. Lord, you know as well as we do that it is a difficult thing when we lose somebody. And so, Father, much grace, much comfort from heaven for the family. In the wonderful name of Jesus, amen. That's it.
Scripture lesson in the Old Testament, Hosea chapter 4, verses 6-8. When people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Isaiah chapter 53, verses 4-6. Surely he has borne our sickness and carried our suffering, yet we considered him plagued, struck by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought our peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. Everyone has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. This is the word of God. The New Testament comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verses 27-30. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Each one must examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. This is the good news.
Yes.
here.
There is no way I can exhaust the depth of what he's done.
But I can scratch the surface enough, and I can talk about it enough to remind us and to maybe stir things up in us. I really encourage you all to really get into the Word and just dig in. Lord, what's going on here? What have you really done for us? And if you've done something for me, then Lord, give me the grace to walk in that. Right? Give me the grace to walk in what you've done for me. The last thing I want to do is, and the last thing any of us wants is for us to do something for somebody, but them not appreciate it. And them not experience it. I mean, if you have, you know, family that has really gone through some hard times, and you come alongside and you said, you know, here's a gift to help you through these hard times, and they just give you the stiff arm and say, no, I just can't believe that. I can't believe that you're that good. And they just resist that. Well, it's the same thing when we resist the things that God has done for us. It's the same thing. Right? And so I don't want to stiff arm God and say, no, I'm just not going to buy that. I'm just not going to buy that good, because he is that good. And he does love us that much. So let's get something out of the way, right out of the gate here. Hosea 4:6, first part of it, says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. So really, it's what we don't know that will hurt us. It's what we don't know that causes us trouble, isn't it? My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. So why are the people of God destroyed? Because they don't know what he's got for them. And they don't understand his will. And so they just get beat up in life. But it's not God's will for us to beat up in life. That's never God's will for us to get beat up in life. God is a good God, and he's a really good Father. He's a really good Dad. Right? He's got good things for us. 2 Corinthians 1:20. For all the promises of God are yes in him, and in him amen, to the glory of God through us. So everything that is in the Word of God, from cover to cover, that God has for us, that he's promised for us, it's for us. It's as good today as it was thousands of years ago. Right. Even though we're in a new and better covenant through Jesus Christ, the promises that were for them thousands of years ago are still for us. Right. Really, the Bible, the promises of God, covers every aspect of our lives. There isn't anything in our lives that the Bible doesn't cover, that the Word of God doesn't cover. God doesn't leave anything out. Right? But if we're ignorant of the promises of God, we can't stand on them. Right? If we disagree with his promises, they won't do us any good. But if we feed on and meditate on the Word of God, we can know what God has for us. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Right? So it is God's will. We all understand it's God's will for everyone who is saved. I think we all understand that it's God's will. God is not willing that any perish, but all come, but all come to Jesus. Amen? It's God's will that every person be saved. It's God's will that we consider ourselves dead to sin and alive to righteousness. What's that mean? That means that part, that thing that wants us to do the wrong thing, we are to consider ourselves dead to that. That's dead. I don't go there anymore. I don't serve that anymore. That's not part of my life anymore. I'm dead to that, right? I'm dead to that. Of course, we all go through this stuff, you know. And I don't know any believer that hasn't missed it. In fact, the Word of God tells us that we all miss it in many ways. And when we miss it, we confess up and say, Father, I'm sorry. Right? Father, I'm sorry. He doesn't hold it over and say, and he doesn't say, well, you said that last week. He doesn't do that. We are forgiven in Christ. It is God's will that we are healed when we're sick. I know if you're sick, you need a healer. And I know everyone here, I know you guys believe that. That is so cool. Because not everybody believes that. Sadly, not everybody believes that. God has promises of provision. God's got his promises of deliverance. He's got promises of salvation. He's got promises of healing. Right? Those promises are all for us. But in order for me to experience the reality of those promises, I need to know what the Bible says. I need to know what the Word of God says. I need to know what I can put my faith on. We're all familiar with the story when, more than a story, it's reality, when Jesus was tempted by the devil. And Jesus defeated the devil repeatedly with the Word of God. What we don't always see is that it's also by the Spirit, because he was baptized with the Spirit before he went out in the wilderness to be tempted. So he had the Spirit of God with him and upon him before he went into the wilderness to go through temptation. So we need to understand that it's not just me quoting the Word of God at the devil and saying, you know, I'm going to do that, because it's the Spirit of God that empowers us. It's the Spirit of God that empowers us to walk a Spirit-led life and say no to that stuff. It's the Spirit of God. Exodus 15:26 says, "If you diligently heed the voice of the Lord your God and do what is right in his sight, give ear to his commandments and keep all his statutes, I will put none of the diseases on you which I have brought on the Egyptians. For I am the Lord who heals you." So when God revealed himself to Israel as their healer, that's the first redemptive name of God that he gave his people. That's the first redemptive name. Now there's a number of other redemptive names of God. And so when we say the Lord's Prayer, it's really good for us to, you know, we're our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. And so what is his name? He says, I am the Lord your healer. He says, I am the Lord your salvation. I am the Lord your righteousness, and so forth. And so if we meditate on these things, when we say, you know, hallowed be your name, then we can appreciate what the name of God means, because he is so much more than just, you know, a God that's out there and watching us. He's so much more. He is a very present healer. He's a very present help in time of trouble. Very present help. 1 John tells us in chapter 4, I think, in at least two places, that God is love, and God, that's his nature. So why is God our healer? Why did God bring the people of Israel out, bring the Jews out of Egypt? Why did God send them all? Because of his great love for us. That's his very nature. God is love. And you know something? If that's his nature, and you're created in God's image, and you've got a Spirit living in you, and you're a new creation, what is your nature? Right? Your nature is love. Love is ought to be our motivator. Why did you give all that food to those people? Because I love them. God loves them and I love them. Why did you spend so many hours with your neighbors helping them out? Because I love them. Right? Because I love them. Why do you guys, from the sound and the video and everything else going on, why do you guys spend all your time doing that? Because you love this place, you love these people, you love God, right? That's why. Thank you, Jesus. So in short, the conditions, where he says, I will put none of these diseases, where he tells us that to give ear to his commandments. In short, the conditions of God are to walk in love towards the fellow man and towards God. Just boil it all down, distill it all down. What's left? Love is what's left. Love of God, love of man. So let's take a look in Isaiah 53, and we're gonna pick apart, and hopefully I don't go take too long here. Isaiah 53:4, 5, and 6. Surely he has borne our sicknesses and carried our suffering. Yet we esteemed him plagued, struck by God, and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. Everyone has turned to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So Isaiah was caught up in the spirit, outside of time, looking forward to something that's taking place 700 or so years later, 750 years, we don't know exactly, but roughly 700 years later, this all took place. But Isaiah is outside of time, and he's watching all this going on. He's in the spirit. Just like when, we read Revelation, John the Apostle, he was in the spirit on the Lord's day, and then he saw all this stuff because he was in the spirit. Not because it was being dictated to him, but because he was in the spirit, he saw it and heard it. He saw that at the whipping post, Jesus bore our sicknesses and carried our pains. He saw that when Jesus was nailed to the cross, he was pierced in his hands and feet for our rebellion, also crowned thorns, for our rebellion and lawlessness, and he was crushed with the weight of the depravity of mankind. And the consequence of that guilt was laid on him. So Jesus was crushed for our iniquity, or our perversion, so that we don't have to carry it anymore. And this is something that nobody talks about, because but if Jesus was crushed for our iniquities. And so what are iniquities? Our iniquities are the bent or the perversion, the depravity to do such a thing. Some people call iniquities the generational sins that falls to the generation because your great-great-grandfather did something really bad and somehow that tendency attached itself to you. That iniquity attached itself to you. So even though you may have never met, certain parents, that tendency that was in them will follow you unless you break that chain, unless you recognize that iniquity, that tendency to do those things was laid on Jesus so that you don't have to do that, so that you're not driven by the thing. I just can't help myself. Jesus is taking care of it so that you can help yourself, so that you can exercise the fruit of something. He set us free from that stuff. And that's really important. When I read that, when I finally got, and it wasn't probably within the last year, I've been walking with Jesus for a long time. And finally, sometime in the last year, I saw it and I went, oh my gosh, I've been missing this all along. This is really good. Thank you, Lord, that I don't have to serve the same demons, the same tendencies my dad did. I've been set free from all that. And that is so cool. Isaiah would have seen the savage crown of thorns that was brutally pressed down on Jesus' head, that we might exchange our fruitless, cursed, carnal thinking for the mind of Christ. The Bible says that we have the mind of Christ. Before Jesus' crucifixion, we didn't have the mind of Christ. After this crucifixion, when we came to Jesus, we were given the mind of Christ. Look it up in 1 Corinthians 2:16, I think it says. I think it's 1 Corinthians. First, we have the mind of Christ. What does that mean? Well, it really means that Jesus lives in here. Holy Spirit lives in here, through him. And we have his mind. We have the mind of Christ living in us. And that's something to really feed on, meditate on. And really just take some time and meditate on that. Lord, what does this mean? What does this mean to me? What does this mean to me that I have the mind of Christ? How can I walk in this mind of Christ? Well, when you're walking in the Spirit, being led by the Spirit, right? We've got the mind of Christ working in our lives. When we get revelation, when you suddenly get it, it's that mind of Christ bringing that revelation. Right? So we don't have to have that cursed thinking we don't have to have the cursed thinking anymore. And I think I might have shared with you guys, when I really gave my heart to Jesus, when I was serious
And everything changed. Everything changed. Except for my tendency to cry really fast. That took a lot of work out. But everything changed. So these are some really powerful truths for us to get a hold of and just feed on, think about, meditate on. You know, to meditate means chew on things. You know, get everything out of it. Get everything out of it. Get all the value you can out of these truths. Everything that trips us up in life was taken care of in Jesus. God didn't leave anything undone in the whipping post, in his time on the cross, in his death, resurrection. God didn't leave anything undone. And when we fully understand that and really get it, then it makes it a whole lot easier to walk in this newness of life. It makes it a whole lot easier to walk in new life. And when I recognize, oh wow, Lord, you did that for me. When I recognize that I don't have to walk in sin anymore. When I recognize that I don't have to be sick anymore. It's not your will, Father, for me to be sick anymore. And you know, I shared one story with you guys last week when God healed my back. And I'm going to share another really short one. That was really cool, but scared me at the same time. I was driving to work. My neck was giving me trouble. I don't know what I did. I was a mechanic, so I was always twisting myself into awkward positions, working on trucks and tractors and feed combines and all that kind of stuff. So my neck was hurting. And I'm driving down the road. I remember going through the light. I was on Harrison Avenue, going through the light of Reynolds Road in Centralia. And I said, Father, ask me in Jesus' name to heal my neck. And I tell you what, freaked me out because it was like there was an angel in my car that grabbed my head and went snap. And my neck was all right. And I'm like, whoa. Freaked me out. I'm like, oh my gosh. Kind of scared me, but I was healed. I have experienced the healing of God. So many times I have experienced the deliverance of God. So many times when I've got myself in trouble, when I've done things I shouldn't, or gone places I shouldn't, God has been there over and over and over. Every time I cried out to the Lord for help, God has been there to rescue me. So let's talk about communion. In this following passage here, 1 Corinthians 11, that Paul's bringing correction to the Corinthian church for their lack of reverence concerning the Lord's Supper. Communion, or the Lord's Supper, is truly a holy occasion to reflect on, meditate on everything Jesus did for us. We're really going to take it back to the life he led, the example he gave us, the things he said. And then his time in the garden, as the way that the whole world was upon. So much that he sweat great drops of blood because he knew what was coming. And he wanted his father, just anyway, you know, let this cup pass from me. If there's any other way, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, your will be done. Right? And so Jesus is really going through it. Really going through great duress. When we take communion, we are bearing in mind, commemorating his time when he was being beaten to a bloody pulp, that cat of nine tails. It wasn't just like a bull whip. It was like a cat of nine tails. So that type of style whip that had chunks of bone and glass in it that would pull the flesh off the person who's being scourged. I mean, Romans weren't nice people. You know, when they're dealing with somebody considered a criminal, they weren't nice people. Right? And so they really, 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 worse than probably any of us can comprehend. I know a lot of us have had some serious pain in our lives, but I bet it's not that level of pain. Right? But when we take communion, we are, you know, concerning his death and his resurrection from the dead for our justification, right? His bloodshed for the forgiveness of our sin. Okay, let's read these verses. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. We're going to look at that in a minute. Each one must examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why so many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. So I'm going to read something here. Woody J. Clark, who's a friend of ours, has written a really good book, Finished Working Across. We've been going through it. Actually, we just finished it. Says something here concerning this passage. Therefore, whoever eats this bread or drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man test, examine, let a man test, and by implication, approve himself washed by the blood. In this manner, let him eat the bread and drink the cup. The one who eats and drinks in adverse judgment on himself is the one who eats and drinks not distinguishing and separating the body from the blood. For this reason, many are sick, weak, and sick among you, and many have died. Not distinguishing between the body and the blood. So it's the examining ourselves in the light of the work of the cross and recognizing that it's only through the blood of Jesus that we are made worthy and guilt-free. It's only through you can't examine yourself and make yourself worthy. It's only through the blood of Jesus. And so when we take communion, we recognize that it's only through the blood of Jesus. And no matter what's happened in my life, it's only through the blood of Jesus that I'm clean, that I'm made worthy. Only through the blood. As mentioned ago, it is of great importance that we recognize that the only reason Jesus' body was beaten so badly was for our healing. I talked about that a little bit last week. The only reason Jesus was beaten was for our healing. Right? So the sacrifices in the Old Testament were types and shadows. They were examples, you know, of what was coming. But the sacrifices were never beaten. Why? Because God was dealing with a sin. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission of sin. So God was dealing with a sin through the sacrifices. And of course, it was a temporary thing. But he wasn't dealing with the body. He was dealing with the sin. So the work for God's desire for us to be healed, Jesus never would have had that with him. Would not have been necessary. Right? God is invested. God is fully invested in the whole man, not just the soul and spirit. You know, there is a day coming when our redemption will be complete. When is that? When we get our new bodies. The church is going to rule and reign with Christ on earth. When we get our new bodies, we need bodies, we need physical bodies to rule with Christ on earth. What that looks like, I don't have any idea. And maybe somebody out there does, but I don't have any idea what that really looks like. But in Christ, we will be ruling and reigning, and we will have glorified bodies that are like Jesus' body. You know, he went through the wall, and then he ate. So he could eat food, and he could walk the walls. He could be here, and then he could be there. So we're going to have bodies like that. And more. So remember what we read at the beginning. God said that his people are destroyed from the lack of knowledge. So it's our failure to recognize what God has done for us. It's our failure to recognize the promises of God. It's our failure to recognize everything Jesus took care of for us at the whipping post. Actually, we get in the garden, and it's live in the garden, and whip the post, the cross, the grave, and his resurrection. All that Jesus did for us out of his great love for us. So when I first wrote this, you know, I got this thing stirring in me. I felt like the Lord was saying, it's almost like I could hear him saying, and maybe you can hear him too. I can almost see Jesus and hear him say to us, church, you are my body. I want for my body what I paid for. My blood was shed for the forgiveness of your sin. So walk in that freedom and be free of sin and condemnation. I was crushed by the weight of your waywardness. So walk in freedom from depravity and perversions. I carried your pains and your sorrows, your sickness and suffering, and was brutally beaten for your healing. So live free of that sickness and suffering. I died and rose again so you can walk in newness of life with the Spirit as a new creation. So walk in that freedom. Father, we thank you for what you've done. We thank you for your great love for us. We thank you for Jesus. Thank you, thank you, thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Jesus sat with two of the disciples and was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. This table is for all believers who wish to know the presence of Christ and to share in the community of God's people.
Amen. Holy God, we praise you and bless you for creation and the gift of life and of your abiding love, which brings us close to you, the source of all blessing. We thank you for revealing your will for us in the giving of the law and preaching of the prophets. We thank you especially that in the fullness of time you sent Jesus, born of Mary, to live in our midst, to share in our suffering, and to accept the pain of death at the hands of those whom Jesus loved. We rejoice that in a perfect victory over the grave you raised Christ with power to become sovereign in your realm. We celebrate the coming of the Holy Spirit to gather your church, by which your work may be done in the world, and through which we share the gift of eternal life with the faithful in every space, every time and place. We praise with joy your holy name, holy, 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 God of love and majesty. The whole earth speaks of your highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord our God. Hosanna in the highest. Yes, Father, we thank you for Jesus. We thank you for the blood that he shed. We thank you for his willingness to go through everything he did. We thank you for Jesus' willingness to live as a man, empowered by God, to show us how to do it. We thank you for Jesus showing us who you are, Father, for he says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. We thank you for Jesus going to that whipping post and taking that horrible beating so that we can be healed, so that we can be free of iniquities so that we can be set free and walk. And we thank you for the cross. We thank you for Jesus being willing to endure the shame of the cross. We thank you for Jesus' death, and we thank you for Jesus' resurrection. Amen. Thank you, Jesus, for your body that was broken for us. And we thank you, Jesus, for your blood that was shed for the remission of our sins. Thank you, Jesus, that you will never remind us of our sins. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, Jesus took the bread and gave thanks. He broke the bread and gave his disciples, saying, "This is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, Jesus also took the cup after saying, "This is the cup. This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." You know, the new covenant that we have with Jesus, the forgiveness of sins, is ratified by his blood. Yeah, ratified by his blood. Right? Consecrate, therefore, by your Holy Spirit, these gifts of bread and the fruit of the vine, and bless us as we receive them at this table. We may offer you our faith and praise. We may be united with Christ and have one and with one another, and we may continue faithful in all things in the strength Christ gives us. We offer ourselves to you, eternal God, and give thanks you have called us to serve you. We now say the prayer Jesus taught us. Our Father, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And before we take the cup, I want to bring out something. Jesus says, do not, and lead us not into temptation. He's telling us to pray that we would not be led into. Why? Because he knows what it's like. He doesn't want us to have to endure that temptation. It's his will that we don't go through these kind of temptations. God bless you guys. Let's take the bread and the cup together. And does everybody know how to open these? Everyone familiar with opening these?
Thank you.
Please join me as we say the prayer of thanksgiving in unison. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are eternally thankful for your great love for us, and that you demonstrated that love by sending your dear Son, Jesus Christ, to live for us and to die for us, so that we can be reconciled to you, and that you raised him from the dead, so we can walk in new life. Amen. With thankfulness, we give in gratitude and joy. With prayerfulness, we give in sacrifice and love. With hopefulness, we give in commitment to God, who He ushers from forth. Thanksgiving offering, Chloe's spray graduation from the Pactoles, and prayer offering for Judy and Cassidy Hernandez tomorrow from the Hernandez Tomorrow family. Thank you, everyone.
Father, thank you for the opportunity for your people to share in the work of the ministry. See their tithes, their offerings, their gifts. Father, this is yours. Your will be done. Your kingdom come and be established. In Jesus' name.
Okay, thank you to Pastor Keith and Pastor Vicky and Mr. Robo for joining us and sharing the Word of God to us today. All worship team members, please utilize the Signal app for any updates and communications. The QR code for the group chat is provided for an easy setup. Upcoming rehearsals are yet to be discussed and planned for as many members as possible to attend. Ladies, the men treated us well with the chicken tikka and rice on Mother's Day. Now it is our turn to take care of them as well as our graduates as we celebrate Father's Day and Graduate Sunday on June 16th. Please sign up for this potluck event in the foyer. Tuesday, June 4th, Tuesday Market Wailua from 3 to 7, volunteers and vendors needed. Wednesday, June 5th, Bible study from 10 to 11 a.m. in the Advent Conference Room. All are welcome to attend. Sunday, June 9th, our guest pastor will be David Makana Milota, and altar flowers will be from Ross and Barnes to Mine, anniversary observance. Worship leader will be Kristen and Andres. There's a finance meeting, and there's also a deacons meeting, and you're to meet in the sanctuary at 12:15. Sunday, June 16th is Father's Day and Graduate Sunday. Our guest pastor will be Jonathan Roach. And there's also a council meeting held over Zoom on another day. Sunday, June 23rd, property team meeting. Does anyone have anything to add? If you're able, please stand and close your neck. I need the appeal.
And we commit our way to you, Nero. It's all yours. Amen.